Okay, wie kann ja du Section Void Okay. Okay. For void growth, there is one model very important, and that is the only model that we will configure. That is the Reich-Gräfe model for void growth. And what we do, in fact, sorry. We consider an infinite piece of material, and in the middle of in the center of that material, we have a void, and the initial radius of the void is r, and then we load that material by prescribing the strain rate in the one direction. And usually plastic deformation occurs under volume constancy. And that means if we have a positive strain in rate in one direction, we must have negative strain rates in the two and three direction, so that the condition for volume constancy is fulfilled. And now one can calculate the growth rate of the void when that strain rate is being prescribed. And the result is seen in that direction. Here we have curves A over A naught. That means that is the growth rate in the loading direction, in the one direction. B over B naught and C over C naught are the growth rates in the two and three direction. Okay? And curves are here shown for different constraint conditions. For example, the lowest constraint condition is that the mean stress over the equivalent stress is 0.333, and that is the condition you have in a tensile test in Young axial loading. And you see then that under that conditions the void grows in the one direction, but in the two and three direction the diameter shrinks. For a higher constraint condition like 0.8, you see that the growth is much stronger in the one direction, and in the two and three directions, the diameter of the void remains approximately constant. For even higher constraint conditions, you have strong growth in the one direction, but also in the two and three direction. Here is more or less the same curve, assuming that the material exhibits linear hardening. And that is the basic equation. That is the growth rate, instantaneous growth rate at a given radius of the void, and that is equal to a certain constant times the prescribed strain rate can E to the power of, and here you see we have that hydrostatic stress, the mean stress divided by the equivalent stress sigma naught. Yeah? That means that the what you see here also, that the constraint has a very significant importance for the growth rate of work in materials. And let's go back. Okay. For example, when you now consider a fracture mechanics specimen, I draw here only thinking for crack plane, the initial crack plane, and B is the specimen thickness. And okay. And second, here we have second for crack length. And so you know that in the center of the specimen we have a very high constraint. The mean stress is much higher than near the side surfaces of the specimen. And therefore, you have a very high growth rate in the center of the specimen and a low growth rate of voids in the near the side surfaces of the specimen. And that is one reason why the crack propagates always much faster in the center of the specimen than in the interior. Okay. So, and that equation is also the basis for many considerations of damage, how the evolution of damage occurs in a material. If we have damage evolution by void growth. Okay, that was void growth, and now we come to coalescence, void coalescence, also Zusammenwachsen der Poren. That is the most difficult thing to model and to consider also from the theoretical point of view. And therefore, I cannot tell too much about that. There exists here also a model of Rice and Johnson that is of some significance. And what I want to repeat that what is a process zone? Here we have a planted crack tip, and the opening of the crack is measured by the crack tip opening displacement. And now we have an intensely deformed zone in front of the crack tip. In fact, it's called the process zone, process zone. And within that process zone, you can assume that all the processes of damage evolution, like void initiation, void growth, mainly occurs. Yeah? And the extension of the process zone can in x direction is written here. It is of the order of 2 to 3 times that crack tip opening displacement. And the fake mogul comes from sleep brain theory. And now Reich and Johnson have developed a model which considers the whole process void initiation, void growth, and coalescence. And what they start with, they assume there is, for example, a certain particle or so where a void will be nucleated in front of the crash tip. And in the model, they assume that the growth of that void is initiated as soon as the process zone touches for the first time the void. It is clear that if we have a higher loading, the crack tip opening displacement increases, and therefore also the extension of the process zone increases. Yeah? And so void growth starts when the process zone touches the position of the void here, and then you have void growth according to the Rice-Tracy model. And when then the distance between, or the bridge between the first void in front of the crash tip and the planted crash tip equals the half diameter of the void, then Reich and Johnson assumed that the bridge then fails and we have void correlations. And if you assume that model, you can now determine for given initial voids in different distances in front of the crack, you can determine the critical CTOD where void correlations occurs and where the crack is initiated. And the result you see here in that diagram. Okay. One remark I want to make, in many materials, you have several generations of particles or inclusions, and therefore you can have also several generations of voids. For example, when you have a steel that contains manganese sulfides that are relatively large, of the order of micrometers, and they have the bonding between the manganese sulfide and and iron is rather weak, and so you have rather early decohesion and initiation of voids. So, in that type of materials, you can have other particles like precipitates, like Fe3C, carbon. Carbides, small carbides that have a very small diameter. And we have learned already that void initiation strongly depends on the diameter of the voids. So you need a much higher load for generating or nucleating a void like a small carbide, like the manganese sulfide. Yeah? And so you often see that on the fracture surface that you have large first generation voids, and then a second generation of much smaller voids in fact developed in regions where the shear stress, where you have a very high shear stress. Yeah? And that mechanism is called void sheet mechanism. Also, I remarked to the cup and cone fracture in tensile specimens. After necking starts of the specimen, you have no uniaxial stress condition anymore. And the highest stress reactivity you have in the center of the specimen. Ich selbst war Wolke, Nische, Gefähr, und Grauzeher. Und dann, ich so weit groß in so Schenkel zu sprechen, wenn ich heilig dann, you have usually that Wolke Sheet Mechanism, that du gehörst, du formst that Kong. No, that Mechanism has nothing to do with Shear, because for King and Marke Griechens, they cannot be a shear fracture, because the direction of the shear is opposite on the left side and on the right side of the specimen. It's rather fake mechanism that the second generation of void is generated at planes where you have a large shear stress. Okay.